people deeper. I'm thinking that's better. Okay. Seem to catch a little echo thing there going on. Hey, I'm glad you're here this morning. Okay, it's good to be here. Okay. We had a little fog coming up from Salina here, but as we got closer here, it cleared up. Okay. We went deeper. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. There's a comic strip. Of course, you know that there's always a comic strip, okay, that I like, and this one's called Baby Blues. It runs in the Salina Journal. I really don't know if it's here in the Mercury here. But it's written by Rick Kidman and Jerry Scott. And it's about a family, okay? There's Mama, and she's Wanda. Dad is named Daryl, and they've got three children. There's Zoe, okay? She's 9 years old, okay? She's a handful, okay? For 3 years, she ruled the roost until her baby brother came along. And so the seven-year-old Hammy, and that's short for Hamish. And they have a baby sister, a one-year-old Wren. And it's just really a lot of fun, and it's very insightful to see the interaction that goes on between the parents and the kids. In this one particular skit or comic strip here, Daryl and Wanda are standing, and they've got Hammy's school report card in their hand. They do not look happy. And they're looking down at Hammy, and the look on Hammy's face is angelic as he looks up at them, okay? And it's so repentant looking, okay? And so hopeful looking, okay? And the dad starts and said, "Hammy, you know, we've just taken a look at your school report." And Hammy questions, "Ann?" And Mom jumps in there and says, "Ann, we've decided we've got to do something about your grades." And Hammy says, "Yes! Woo! I thought you were going to say I had to do something about my grades." And he goes off whistling a little happy tune. And his parents are looking at each other like, "What just happened here?" Okay. I don't think it went exactly the way that they wanted it to go. But, you know, I thought of that because we're entering the season of Lent this week. Lent begins, it's the 40-day plus the 6 Sundays of a period which occurs before Easter. And that time period called Lent is a time when we have an opportunity, all of us, in the Christian faith, and even some who are in other faiths, take that as an opportunity to take a look at themselves, to choose to let go of the things that are not working, the things that are not being a blessing in their lives, and to take on experiences and opportunities to provide service. Unlike Hammy, the season of Lent is something that we've got to work on. We've got to work on ourselves in preparation for our own spiritual resurrection and renewal and revitalization, which is Easter. Some people, in observing Lent, choose to give up certain foods. Give up the number 3 from McDonald's, okay? Even the fries. Give up eating meat, for example, and just eat fish. Some people give up chocolate and candies and all kinds of things like that. And other people choose to give up their time. And they invest that time in service activities through their church or in their community. There are all kinds of ways to practice this experience called Lent. But the main thing here, as we understand it in Unity, is that for us, when we practice this time period of preparation for Easter, the inner experience of revitalization and renewal, that it's important that we not only be doing, but we be being. We be about the work of being, expressing who we are as children of God, as expressions, or as I like to say, outpressions of God in our world. So the doing is important, and what we choose to do, what we choose to let go of, and what we choose to take on as a project during this time to prepare, when we prepare our souls for the Easter experience. All of this is important, but in all of this, being who we be. On Wednesday, March 1st, again, the Lenten season begins and is called Ash Wednesday. And a lot of churches, although we don't do this in Unity, the Catholic Church, the priests will be making the sign of the cross on the forehead of their members and their congregants with ashes that are made from the burnt palm leaves from last Sunday's Easter celebration. And they do this as a sign of repentance, a sign of giving up the old self and being willing to be renewed. Ashes, of course, come from something that the life is now not there. And it's a symbol of renewal, transformation. The phoenix, out of the ashes, the phoenix rises into new life. Okay. And in a sense, we are like that on a soul spiritual level. In our experiences in life, we often go through a period or this time of change, this experience of transformation where we too must rise, move through a difficulty and rise up. I'm not sure exactly why, how it is that Lent actually was organized, because there actually is not any official recording of the season of Lent in the Bible. And Jesus didn't speak about it. And why the ascription of 40 days to this period? Well, we do understand that to the Hebrews, the number 40 was a magical number. It represented a completed cycle. And remember that in the Bible, Jesus, before he began his ministry, he spent 40 days and nights in the wilderness fasting. The Hebrew people, after Moses went up, you know, to Pharaoh and let my people go, and they moved out. They spent 40 years in the wilderness before they were able to enter the promised land. And during that time, there was a lot of change and transformation that had to happen within the hearts and minds of the people, just like us. But we do understand that Easter, like Christmas and like so many spiritual or religious holidays, gives us an opportunity to pause from our daily life. It gives us an opportunity to reflect on something beyond ourselves, as well as connecting with other people, bonding with other people. It gives us an opportunity to reconnect with God, that presence in us. As Unity students, we practice Lent by simply devoting more time to prayer, meditation, and thoughtful reflection. But we are also welcome to give up that chocolate bar, okay? To give up that number 3. Oh, you know, I'll go to number 9, the fish sandwich, okay? With cheese on it, that's pretty good, okay? But why do people give up things? Okay. There was a little story about this boy. He was in a Sunday school class, and for the life of him, he couldn't figure out why we're being asked to give up the things that we love, the things that we enjoy, the things that bring us happiness. And one of the teachers said, well, you don't have to give up the things that you enjoy. Think about giving up the things that you don't enjoy. Think about giving up the things that don't bring this spirit, this upliftment, this inspiration in your life. Think about those things and give those up, because that too is practicing Lent. That too is a preparation for this renewal that we call Easter. And that made sense to him. You know, it makes sense to me too. So the number 3 is back in. But perhaps I will do a check on my attitude. We were talking this morning, and I'm thinking that someone said something about, well, we can't make up time, okay? And I said, well, I do. And I've shared an experience with you where I, I learned a lesson from making up time on the highway. And one of the classmates of mine said, you don't still do that, do you? And I thought, well, not really. You know, I stay within 5 miles per hour over the speed limit. Okay? So I think that's pretty safe. Okay, but giving up other aspects, things that are not conducive to our joy and happiness, this too is a celebration, a participation in what we call Lent. And I'd like to share a story with you. This is a true story, and it happened many years ago. But it still remains vivid in my mind because it was a deep, deep experience for me. I served as a volunteer clergy for the chemical dependency program at St. John's Hospital when that was there in Salina. And I did this for a number of years. And it was really rewarding work. I helped with those individuals going through their AA program and listening to them share their fifth step with me. For those of you who are not familiar with that, the fourth and fifth steps of AA are critical healing steps for someone going through the throes of addiction. These are the steps where that person is asked to take an unflinching look at themselves, where they've been, what they've done, what they've thought, how they have felt about things. And the fifth step is where they are being asked to acknowledge the wrongs that they have done to God, to themselves, and to another human being. And I set up appointments with some of these folks at my church. I had an office at my church, and I felt it was more private there. And this young man came to me, and in the sharing, I realized that he had been burdened for 12 years with a pain that he could not release from something that had occurred. And as we're visiting, I asked him to share that. I asked him, was he willing to let that go? He wasn't sure that he was, but the tears began to fall down his face, and he began to share with me that 12 years before our meeting, he and his son were drunk, and they fell into an argument. And his son grabbed one of the guns that was there in their home, and he shot at his father. His intent was not to hit him, but he got so angry he just fired that gun. Okay, and this man, and I don't even remember his name now, but he said that I just got so enraged. And my son took off running through the house, okay? He said, I just got so enraged, I grabbed the shotgun, and he took off after the boy. And he was just intending to frighten the boy. He shot that shotgun, and it entered the boy's skull, and he fell dead on the kitchen floor. And as he was telling the story, and the river was flowing, okay, I just was really, really touched. I'd never really counseled someone who had killed someone that they love. And he shared with me that day his life ended. And he turned to alcohol because he felt a need to be punished. He condemned himself, and he said he didn't even want to think about what God might think about him. That was too terrifying. And so he used alcohol to numb himself. And it was destroying whatever was left of his relationship. His wife did find a way to forgive him, but his daughter never did. And most importantly, he did not understand that he could accept forgiveness of himself. And we spent a great deal talking about what forgiveness is. My understanding of it, his understanding of it, his concept of God. And I shared with him what my concept of God was. not only the transcendent spirit out there in charge of the world and the universes, but that immanent presence that dwells within us, that we can make contact with, that we can feel, that we can experience, that we can allow to flow through us as we connect with our world. I spoke about that God that loves eternally, that forgives eternally. And sharing with him that my belief that when we love someone, they are always a part of us. And we are all connected in life because spirit is one. I led this man in an exercise, a spiritual exercise, using the inner faculties of faith, of love, and imagination. And he allowed himself to communicate with his son, who had passed on these 12 years. And he asked his son for forgiveness. And he received his son's forgiveness and his son's love. And from this, through more tears, he realized that he could accept forgiveness of himself. This made all the difference in his world. From that moment on, he began on the road to healing and wholeness. Now, I never made contact with this person again, but when he left my office, there was a light on there that wasn't there before, that couldn't be seen or felt before. There was an upliftment. And besides the fact that this was a tragedy, there was a joy about the possibility of living again. Because he didn't think that he was worthy to live. But he understood that God is love and that he could choose to let this go. He did not diminish what he did and how that impacted so many people, but he chose to let the hurt, the anger at himself, the will to self-annihilate, he chose to let that go and let God in. Because I truly believe that that was definitely the work of God in this man, for him to be able to let this go and decide from that point that he was going to live. I'm hoping that he went on to be a light in his world and to share upliftment and encouragement to others. But Lent is about just this very thing. It's about forgiveness and releasing ourselves. It's about forgiving others and releasing them, those that we have held in bondage in our mind. Lent is our opportunity to come up higher. It is for rising in consciousness, that they say, to higher ground. And you know, as we grow spiritually, we can look back at our lives and we can be open to that presence in us that guides and directs us and helps us to know what it is we need to truly let go of and how we may let more of God express in and through us. In Unity, we offer many tools which we can use during this Lenten season to prepare our hearts and our consciousness for Easter. Learning what it means to forgive ourselves and to forgive others is a very important tool. But so are the tools of denial and affirmations, the yes and no properties of our mind. This man, in this experience, he had to say no. He had to deny that what happened in the past had the power in the present to keep God's light and love and happiness from being experienced in his life. He had, in error, thought that he was unworthy for this. And so one of the first things he had to do was use a denial, a statement, a thought, an attitude that said, even though I have done this in the past, I have learned from my mistake, and this experience will no longer keep God's good from actuating in my life experience. And Charles Fillmore said that when we use a denial, we should use it lightly, as if we are brushing off a cobweb that's on our sleeve or something like that, and then immediately follow that with an affirmation. And I kind of think of it kind of like when you're pulling weeds, sometimes those weeds go down real deep, okay? And you've got to dig, because there are some folks who don't use denial and don't think that we actually need to use denials. But I think that there are times when that root is so deep that you do actually need to dig it out. And that's what a denial does. It doesn't change the situation. It didn't change the situation that occurred in this man's life. But it took back the power that he had given it, the energy that he had put in it to cause him to suffer. So the denial helps us pull back to ourselves the energy that we have given away to negative experiences. And an affirmation is a positive statement about, basically it's about who we are and our connection to God. An affirmation doesn't, again, it doesn't, it's not a magical thing that changes a situation. This situation in this man's life was in the past and done. And I'm trying to think what that was. There was a saying that an affirmation, let's see, an affirmation doesn't erase the past, but it enlarges the present. And I believe that. So this man, during this process, chose to let God. And that means letting good again come into his life. Because good is just the elongated expression for God. He had to affirm, I am God's beloved child. I am learning from my mistakes. I am loved. I am forgiven. And I move forward in my new life now. This is a lesson for all of us. Denial and affirmation are the yes and no of consciousness. And to be honest with you, I think that during Lent and in life, we had to call upon these tools that we have been given here. We, again, are not denying the fact that if we've got a broken arm, we're denying the fact that it's a broken arm. What we deny is the fact that this broken arm, we deny that this broken arm can keep God's good from being experienced in our life. So it's not changing the fact of a broken arm, but it's changing the effect of the broken arm in our experience. This makes a world of difference. We can choose to reframe our experiences and let in the light that God is in us. We can choose to let go of things, the holding to the attachment of things, to feelings, to attitudes. And we can hold on to the truth that we see beyond that appearance. And the only reason that we don't see the possibilities are because we're holding on to that particular experience. Helen Keller, I think, said that the reason people, when a door closes, the reason that people don't see the other door that's open is because they're still banging on the one that's closed. Wake up. Be renewed. Paul said, be renewed, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Hold on to the truth which comes from letting God work for you until it sings itself into your life experience. And then you will find that you are free always to be what your heart truly desires during Lent and during your life. God bless you.